the comedy show yesterday realized that there was a portion where my wife shared some personal stories, some funny and humorous stories of our events, and of course that was one of them about my great singing ability and how that's often been caught on the microphone by people. Speaking of the past, 5 years ago this week, it was announced that I was changing jobs. Some of you know I used to be in the financial field here in this community, and 5 years ago, Becky Couts stood right up here and read a letter that finally Lauren Ekdahl was going to retire. And subsequently, I was going to be appointed as your pastor. Now, that change in careers really wasn't that radical. I'd already been a pastor for 16 years before my foray into banking and wine serving and newspaper delivery and several other odd jobs. But those thoughts of that transition 5 years ago were kind of echoing as I read this part in John Ortberg's book, Who Is This Man? He writes, Jesus spent most of his adult life as a blue-collar worker, crafting benches and tables. Then one day he decided to change jobs. I write these words on a plane sitting next to a man named Timothy, whom I just met, a distinguished visiting scholar at Stanford University. Timothy's father grew up in an illiterate untouchable in India, who learned to read and write because Jesus changed jobs. One Sabbath, Jesus went to the synagogue in his hometown, picked up a scroll, and read a passage in Isaiah, and then sat down. Sitting down is the traditional teaching posture of a rabbi, the scholar teachers of Israel. When Jesus sat down, he was proclaiming his new occupation. He claimed in his first message that God is a Gentile lover ready to embrace anybody. Jesus claimed to know this. By the end of his sermon, the congregation was so furious that they drove him out of town and attempted to throw him off a cliff. They resisted his knowledge. Now, I don't know what I would have done if after my first sermon, people would have reacted that way. I think I probably would have gotten a bit discouraged. I know this because I've certainly counseled with other pastors that have received similar discouragement when people have complained about their sermons, or that they don't visit enough, or about the way they dress, or what kind of car they drive, or even with the way of the actions of their children. I know I'm blessed. I have a father and a grandfather that are in the business, so it's kind of given me a unique perspective on things that other pastors don't have, especially when people question my knowledge. Now, I've already shared with you some things that you learned about me yesterday, and one of the things that those of you that attended the event yesterday learned is that my first 4 years, while I was in seminary, I served two churches in southeast Nebraska. And one thing that I heard, and I should say one thing, probably the number one thing that I heard over and 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 over when I was serving those churches while I was in seminary was, don't let seminary change you. I heard that a lot. And so, when you think about it, what does that phrase mean? What really is at the heart of that phrase? It usually goes like this. We like you, Pastor. We like who you are. But you're going to learn some stuff down there that we don't agree with, and it's going to change you. And that might mean doing something different in worship, or maybe a different hymn, or preaching about something in the Bible that we don't like or agree with. But at the heart, that phrase is an acknowledgement that knowledge, more knowledge, too much knowledge is a bad thing. But is it? You know, Jesus was referred to as rabbi 11 times in Scripture. And rabbis just are teachers. They're educators at heart. Now, what was Jesus teaching was change. We tend to think of teaching as just passing down the knowledge. Every day, I pick up Olivia from school. Now, I know that this is going to end when she turns 16. So I'm enjoying these last few months to be able to do that. Now, when I used to pick up Olivia, I'd always ask her, so how was school today? It'd be absolute silence in the car. Now I ask her, what did you learn? And I'll tell you what she shares. She is passing on that knowledge of what she has learned in school. Now I want you to hold that thought for a second as we talk about who is this man. John Overka, we've been following his study during our 9 o'clock hour, and we have devoted our Lenten studies to this man and what he writes about. And already we've learned some things. We've talked about vulnerability. And this, if you remember his teachings on that, vulnerability literally means death. It literally means death on the cross. It doesn't mean that we attack our enemies. It doesn't mean that we gloat after winning. It doesn't mean that we convince our followers to write hate letters to people we don't agree with. He was teaching about change. And then we had a discussion about planting a seed. A seed that once germinated gets us to see a new image of God. And this image is focused on equality and bestowed worth. Again, a teaching on change. So we come to that question about today's sermon title. So why isn't this man great? Well, by the standards of Jesus' day, he didn't match up. Think about it. When Jesus died, there were no buildings with his name on it. He didn't lead a nation, let alone a city council. He failed to make any significant changes in his life. And worst of all, he was humble. I mean, just listen to how Paul describes him.
Today I'm reading from Philippians, the second chapter, first 11 verses. Your life in Christ makes you strong. And his love comforts you. You have fellowship. Oops, too dangerous. I do this with my bells, too. Second page doesn't want to come over.
It's because you don't want to lick your fingers, you know.
Exactly. Fellowship with the Spirit, and you have kindness and compassion for one another. I urge you then to make me completely happy by having the same thoughts, sharing the same love, and being one in soul and mind. Don't do anything from selfish ambition or from a cheap desire to boast, but be humble toward one another, always considering others better than yourselves. And look out for one another's interests. Not just for your own. The attitudes you have is the one that Christ Jesus had. He always had the nature of God, but he did not think that by force he should try to remain equal with God. Instead of this, of his own free will, he gave up all he had and took the nature of a servant. He became like a human being and appeared in human likeness. He was humble and walked the path of obedience all the way to death, his death on the cross. For this reason, God raised him to the highest place above and gave him the name that is greater than any other name. And so, in honor of the name of Jesus, all beings in heaven, on earth, and in the world below will fall on their knees. And all will openly proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
You know, in Jesus' time, humbleness got you nowhere. To be humble meant that you were walked over, forgotten, left behind. And there was no way that you could lead a people or a nation, let alone a populace, for change if you were humble. He was not a great man. But just look at these examples. Out of the first 138 colleges and universities that were founded in America, the first 138, 92% of those were founded by followers of this man. The Slavic people had no alphabet, and yet they call it Cyrillic because it was founded and started by a guy by the name of Saint Cyril, who was a missionary to the people and found they didn't have a written language. And if these people were going to be able to read Scripture, to write about Jesus, to talk about Jesus, they needed a written alphabet. He invented an alphabet. Imagine that. Or take this, clocks. Clocks were invented because monks needed to know what time to pray. So when you're late, just thank the monks for that. Or eyeglasses. The first mention of eyeglasses was in a sermon in the year 1300. Because what were monks doing? They needed to be able to see, oh my gosh, they needed to be able to see Scripture through eyeglasses. All this from a man who never wrote anything in his lifetime, who was not even considered great in his days. Now, I want you to know, there's no helium in this. We don't have to worry about the balloon staying up there after I let it go. This balloon represents greatness. What happens every time you get onto an airplane? Who do you pass? All the people that sat there before, the ones that can afford it, as they're watching you, they represent greatness, right? Back when I was using credit cards, and I used them a lot, and I would max out those credit cards, and I would get that thing in the mail that would say, we're going to increase your credit limit. In fact, we're going to give you an upgrade from a silver to a gold to a platinum to a platinum silver gold with diamonds credit card. The credit card company was telling me to be greater is to use it more. We've already talked about that the color purple represents wealth and royalty. If you listen to the Dave Ramsey show, he says that success is to live in a paid-for house. But as I said, I worked in the financial field, and I can tell you that idea hasn't caught on to society. What I saw is that greatness was whatever kind of vehicle, nice vehicle you could have parked in the parking lot, and you could afford the payment. In our society, greatness is defined by winning. Winning so much that you get tired of winning. In Jesus' time, greatness was defined by same stuff. Not much has changed. I mean, just listen to this description from the Emperor Caesar Augustus about himself. 3 times I triumphed at oration. 21 times I was named emperor. The Senate voted yet more triumph for me, which I declined because of victories won by me. The Senate voted thanks for me to the immortal gods. 55 times in my triumphs, 9 kings or children of kings were led before my chariot. I had been counseled 13 times. I was highest ranking senator for 40 years. I held the office of pontificate, maximus, all citizens with one accord, unceasingly prayed in every holy place for my well-being. This balloon is not Jesus. Jesus' values would not fill this balloon with air. I was able to tie this so quickly in the first service. Jesus was not a great man, certainly to those whose opinions mattered most, certainly to those in society, at least anyone who wanted to follow him, let alone after his death. Listen to this quote. So when the Apostle Paul started a letter to people in Rome by describing himself not as a citizen of the Roman Empire, which he was, not as a wearer of the toga, but as a slave of Christ Jesus, he was committing social suicide. No one talked that way. Might as well mark your Facebook status loser and try to get a date. So who is this man that we would build churches for, that we would pray to, that we ask for blessings of food and shelter, transportation to work from school and clothing, and certainly ask that we don't get a virus and get sick and die? Well, he was not a great man. Now, I realize that that's not a great way to build a church. I realize that does not make us a popular place to worship. or a cool trend to start with your friends. But there's something about this man who won't go away. There's something about this man where followers will not talk about greatness, but humbleness. Remember that letter that Bruce read to you from Paul? Listen to what Ortberg writes about. Joseph Hellman offered a moving explanation to an oddity in the books of Acts. At Philippi, a Roman colony, Paul is arrested and badly beaten. After he is released, he protests that he is a Roman citizen. The officials are apologetic and frightened to hear this. They have violated Roman law by beating a Roman citizen. But this raises the obvious question. Why didn't Paul tell them he was a Roman citizen before they beat him? Who sits on a get-out-of-jail-free card? Paul was forming a little outpost to Jesus' community. When the church would get started, Paul knew that there might be a couple of elite people in it, but not many. Mostly it will be the non-elite. But they're supposed to be a family now. Everything inside them, all their customs, training, thinking, language, habits, have taught them that life is about the pecking order. You keep people down. You try to climb up. Now Paul is going to try to make a family so they become brothers and sisters. How could that be done? Paul also knew that these nobodies would suffer for their faith. They would have little power. Paul knew he could have used his status as a citizen to avoid suffering. The low-status members of the church would not have that option. He saw in this predicament a painful and glorious opportunity. So Paul did something irrational. He humbled himself. He refused to consider citizenship in Rome something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself like a non-citizen, like a nobody. This week, Nebraska football started spring practice. What a week to start spring practice. And on Monday, they had a press conference after the first practice, and then I watched, and the first player that came out to speak was a guy by the name of Cam Taylor-Britt. He's a defensive back, and his shirt said, "Humble over hype." Lent is a reminder that these values do matter, that the seeds are planted for a future generation. I love this quote from the book. It wasn't only a man who died on a cross. In a strange way, a culture was dying too, though no one knew it yet. In that culture, honor meant status. Shame meant worthlessness. Crucifixion was the ultimate shame. When Jesus was teaching, it was not an exchange of ideas, but a lesson for change. A change of culture, a change of status, a change in power and wealth, a change in title, and definitely a change about who's winning. Humbleness does that. You know, this week as we watched COVID-19 spread from nation to nation, community to community, people to people, what did we see? The virus makes no distinction whether you are great or not. It's going to get you whether you're humble or not, but definitely if you're not great, if you're great or not. So, what does greatness mean? The great ones are those that are making an impact for change. Remember Timothy, that story that I shared with you at the beginning of this message? Listen to how Ortberg finishes the story. Timothy told me how his father David was brought up in a Dalit, outcast family in Maharashtra, India. He knew that his generations were cursed by the gods of Hindu pantheon to be left in this state of rejection, both by religion and by citizens of upper caste. As an illiterate, untouchable Dalit, David could not enter the temple of his village. So he set out on a 45-mile pilgrimage by foot to get to a glimpse of the nearest Hindu temple of any significance. He had to wait in line 3 weeks. Standing in line, not knowing if he would be allowed in, he met a missionary who told him that Jesus taught him he had not been cursed by God, but was loved by God. David had grown up forbidden to enter a temple or bathe in a river on an auspicious day to keep them undefiled for higher castes. It took 6 months for David to absorb the notion that God loved him. When David decided to follow this Jesus, he was beaten by his family and thrown out of his village. He returned to the missionary who gave him shelter and taught him to read and write. He eventually graduated from Union Biblical Seminary in Maharishta, and then he planted churches as well as ran a boarding school for little girls rescued from temple prostitution. For his 70th birthday, David decided to adopt a leper colony outside of Pune, India, and built a church among the lepers. And every Thursday, he and his wife would go to Yerwada prison in Pune, the place where Mohandas Gandhi once was confined, and prayed with inmates on death row. Timothy, now the son who's sitting with Ortberg on the plane, Timothy graduated with an engineering degree, an MBA from Duke University, and an advanced degree from Moore College, Sydney. And he currently serves as a distinguished visiting scholar at Stanford University. He explained the vast amounts of higher education in India have their roots in this Jesus movement. The Stanford family who began that university, where Timothy is now a scholar, also supported in its early days the church in Menlo Park that I now serve. And then I love this line. The ripples do not stop. Jesus entered the world wearing swaddling clothes and exited with the towel of the slave. Jesus was not a great man, but I think he's redefining what greatness is all.